There's a lot of dental issues on the fruitarian diet, and for a number of reasons. Again, like I said, D and B12, these are not things that are normally in food. So when you go from a fortified diet to an unfortified diet, if you're lacking in D, that can contribute to it. You could have weak dental genetics that makes you more susceptible. There are people from certain countries that have really powerful dental genetics. I mean, really strong, bulletproof teeth, and nothing harms their teeth. Their teeth are perfect. You can't do anything to them. They'll never get a cavity. But that's not true. Today we're getting weak dental genetics, our jaws are getting smaller, our teeth are getting crowded. Sometimes one has to be, or two have to be taken out to stop the overcrowding effect. And then you could be eating unripe citrus. There's a number of things. You could be eating unripe citrus, so it has a higher acid content, the citric acid, the pH, it's just higher. So that's softening the enamel of teeth and rotting away. There's a number of things that could cause dental issues. So lack of sufficient minerals, eating unripe citrus, weak dental genetics, and all these things conspire, so to speak, right? But there are things you can do to offset that. Make sure you're eating ripe citrus. Rinse your mouth out after eating any kind of citrus. It was just regular water. Just rinse it out, let it stay in there for a minute, then spit it out. The minerals, the inorganic minerals in the water will just help re-harden the softened enamel in your teeth from eating possibly unripe citrus. I like rinsing my mouth out with an iodine mouth rinse that I make myself. It's very inexpensive. And I just rinse it in my mouth and then spit it out before I go to sleep. That brings down the bacterial count, helps to strengthen the enamel. And I have weak dental genetics. I should say that. I have very weak dental genetics, so I have to go that extra mile to do that. Maybe not everybody needs to do that and go that far, but if you have weak dental genetics, yeah, you should definitely do something like that. On my website, I have a dental blog in the EDU section of my website that really goes into all this stuff, that has all these answers. Animals in nature fast when they feel they need to, or when their bodies tell them to, basically, and your body tells you to fast because you lose your appetite. You lose your appetite, you just don't eat. And over the last 25 years, a couple of times, I've just realized I've had no appetite. Since I only eat when I'm hungry, and I never eat when I'm not hungry, there have been days I've just, hey, I haven't been hungry all day. Oh, my body must be dealing with something. I didn't feel bad, but there was a 7-day fast, another approximate 7-day fast, 21-day fast, and a 24-day fast over the last 25 years. In each of those times, it was a body-initiated fast. I just didn't have hunger, and I didn't eat until I got hungry again. Now, not everybody can do that. Not everybody can fast until true hunger returns. In other words, I was in a really good state of health, but something, maybe a pathogen, I know a couple of times it was definitely a virus or something, because it was just going around. Everybody was like just dropping dead, not really, but you know, they were just laid up. And there I was, just not eating. That was my only symptom. I think I might have had a low-grade fever for, you know, like half a day of the 21 days. But otherwise, I felt fine. Of course, I lost weight, about half a pound a day. But that's natural. That's what happens when you fast. So that's a body-initiated fast. So I'm in favor of that. I'm in favor of doing what your body wants you to do. When your body wants you to go to the bathroom, I recommend going to the bathroom. When your body wants you to sleep, I recommend going to sleep. Not trying to take no-dos or caffeine or something to stay awake. Pull off the road, go to sleep. And when your body wants you to not eat by not making you hungry, I advise not eating. But some people do what's called intentional fasting, where they decide to fast, maybe one day a week, maybe 3 days a month, maybe 2 weeks a year, you know, something that really has nothing to do with what the body wants. It has to do with the calendar. That's not really respecting the body. What if your body doesn't want you to fast? What if it's like dealing with a nutritional insufficiency, a dietary caused nutritional insufficiency, and you decide to fast, and you do it, and your body's like, what are you doing? Well, it doesn't really know you're doing it consciously. It just figures no food is around. So it's like, oh my God, this is difficult enough getting enough chromium right now, and now there's no food around, and it's been 2 weeks, and oh my God. So you're just deepening a nutritional deficiency that you may have. So it's a very complicated issue. It's not as straightforward as some fasting practitioners would have you believe, maybe because they're fasting practitioners, I don't know. I'm not a fasting practitioner, but I know a heck of a lot about fasting. I don't have to have fasted, you know, hundreds of people to know about fasting and when to do it, when not to do it. And there are times you really should do it, and you should always do it supervised, unless you're in the peak of health, you know, you've been doing this for 24 years, and you know you'll be able to fast to completion. Otherwise, earlier on, if you're doing an extended water-only fast, you should probably do it with supervision so that you can be tested to make sure you don't go past the point where the body has used all the basic, you know, your your resources, your fat resources, and now it's going to turn to protein. You don't want to go past that point. So a really good fasting place will help you do that. Well, first I should say, it's complicated initially. Yeah, it's complicated initially because, number one, it's so different than what you have been doing. I mean, if you were raised eating a raw vegan fruit-based diet from birth, would it be complicated? Well, no, it really wouldn't, because you were raised eating that way, you know, and you were taught, and it was just natural. It's like falling off a log. It's easy. But for most people, they weren't raised that way. So when they're taught, when they see the wisdom of doing it, and they realize that, yeah, this is going to be an excellent investment in my future health, and I want to do this. It's good for me. It's good for the planet. It's good for the other animals. Win, 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 win. So they do this, and it's a paradigm shift. That's what I'm trying to say. It's a major paradigm shift, and it's going to seem difficult at first. And by the way, some of the worst plans are the simple plans. Are the plans that you're presented with it, like, whoa, this is simple, I can do this. No, if it's really too simple, that might not be really the best plan. It might not be in your body's best interest. So it's going to be a little complex, because you have to then learn about, okay, how do I make sure now I get enough D and B12 that I'm coming off a fortified diet to a non-fortified diet? Where do I live, you know, in the planet relationship, with the relationship to getting enough D? What about ensuring that I get enough of all the fruits and vegetables if I'm eating nutritionally subpar food? That's really where it is. It's, you know, getting enough sleep, that's not complicated. You know, get enough sleep. Don't wake up to an alarm clock. Wake up on your own, you know, let your body wake you up. Go to the bathroom when your body wants you to. That's always been easy. That's a no-brainer. So it can be complicated, but it's just in the beginning. But it doesn't have to be, you know, it doesn't have to be difficult. So it can be complex, but it shouldn't be difficult. It shouldn't be hard to understand. If you can't understand what you're being taught, that's awful, because you're not going to be able to know if you're going in the wrong direction or not. You might draw erroneous conclusions. That happens a lot. So that's another reason it can be complex, because there's a learning curve. I forgot that. Yeah, the learning curve that you need to know. Because I don't advise following any one person. I don't advise following me or any other practitioner out there. I advise looking at this as a researcher, not as a student. Now, researcher compared to student, which is easier? Well, student, you just learn, maybe ask a question of clarification every now and then. You study, you memorize, this is what I got to do. Researchers don't do that. They take in the information and they vet all the information, and they take it in from various sources because they're looking for the truth. That's what a researcher does. But if you're looking for the best diet, the one that your body is really designed to have, you don't want to just put all your faith into one particular mentor or guru, because what if they have 80% or 90% correct information, but they have 10% incorrect information? But you're going to follow them 100%. Now you're following 10%, 10 or 20% incorrect information, and that could mean the difference between you surviving or thriving. And yeah, if you survive, you'll be surviving better than 95% of the population, but that's still not thriving. Thriving is living to your, you know, your normal life expectancy, ripe old age, dying in your sleep of nothing specific, never being in the hospital unless you're in there to visit somebody else. That's thriving.